Are you with us, Taz?
I am here. Hi, Lou.
Fantastic. Thanks, Taz. Really, really grateful for you to join us. And you're going to talk about now some of your experiences from kind of two sides, from a GP perspective and an innovator. So I'll hand over to you now. Thanks, Taz.
Thanks, Lou. I don't know whether you can see me, but this is my only slide. And first of all, I just want to say thanks to Richard. Always too kind, really, in, you know, really talking about myself and what we've done, but really some amazing support we've had from all the guys at Yorkshire and Humber HSN. I can't thank them enough for what they've done to support me over the last 5 years. But just as an introduction, my name's Taz Aldawould. I'm a part-time GP in Bradford. I'm the Chief Clinical Information Officer for Bradford District in Craven CCG, and I'm also the founder and CEO of Aldawould. And hopefully I'm going to give you some insights from each of these perspectives. I unfortunately couldn't make yesterday's programme, but I have been on this morning, and I've learned a lot, and I've cut out some bits that I think will overlap. I don't want to repeat what others have said, but there are some bits I want to build on. One or two of the things that Richard said, I'm going to build on as well. So, birds of a feather flock together. That's actually derived from one of Plato's books, his masterpiece. It's called The Republic. And he went on to say that love those who are like themselves. So that's people who love those who like themselves. And Aristotle said, love those who like themselves as well. So I learned something new. It's called homophily. And that's the tendency for people to seek out or be attracted to those who are similar to themselves. People surround themselves by people who think the same, who mirror our own perspectives, and who confirm our own prejudices. And actually, we know from evidence from brain scanners that indicates when others reflect our own thoughts back to us, it actually stimulates the pleasure centers in our brains. So it was actually really great to hear Richard talk about it. I think the HSN are going through some unconscious bias training. And I wanted to just talk a little bit about that because I was really inspired by a book. And again, I've got no shares in this book or anything. I just think this author's fantastic. Matthew Syed, he published a book called Rebel Ideas, The Power of Diverse Thinking. And he introduced lots of concepts to me, mainly around unconscious bias. And he talks about intellectual conformity. And he says groups of people that can be individually intelligent, but collectively are quite stupid, in his words. And he actually goes on to describe the preventable tragedy of the September 11th attacks. And he talked quite a lot in detail around the CIA, you know, Central Intelligence Agency, individually, very good perspective, but collectively blind due to their lack of diversity of both the analysts and those in the field. And that homogeneity undermined the world's, one of the world's most foremost intelligence agencies. And in complex problems, no one person will have all the relevant insights. And what I do know is that the digital health interventions are complex interventions. So I just wanted to talk a bit about the Good Things Foundation. I came across them recently. They work with the NHS and other partners to bring digital health inclusion to those that are most excluded and whom digital can probably have the biggest benefits. And they say that an estimated 11.9 million people in the UK don't have full essential digital skills to make use of health services. And they're most likely to be those that are socially excluded, hard to reach, and those that suffer from poorer health. And that exposes a 19-year difference in health life expectancy between the most deprived and the least deprived in our communities. They also say the good news around return on investment. They say that we get a £6.40 return on investment for every £1 invested in digital health inclusion. I was absolutely blown away by that. I also want to talk about some of the evidence. Recently published Workforce Race Equality Standard, the RES report, that there is still a long way to go. Someone this morning talked about changing her name on a CV, and this report, which I read, talks about white candidates having almost double the chance of being appointed to a senior role in the NHS compared to a black or ethnic minority candidate. And actually, research also shows that diverse teams, especially in technology organisations, are more likely to be intelligent, creative, they perform better. We know that women on boards of the top companies in the world perform better, and they're better at creating solutions for a diverse consumer base. And all those are necessary components of solving the toughest healthcare problems that we have and health equity challenges. We need to ensure we don't create organizations that are homogenized, like the CIA intelligence agency, but that's happening and that's present within organizations in the UK, even the NHS. And organizations also need to consider not only geographical and race, but neurodiversity. So for example, clinically, I know that some patients with autism, Asperger's, they have superhuman abilities to spot patterns that other people can't see. So they can bring so much to an organization. So excluding anyone from that workplace essentially shuts out skills that could be really highly valuable to organizations. If we want to truly improve healthcare, it's really important that we have industry leaders, designers, creators represent all of the perspectives, nuances, cultures, trends, and needs of the members in the health communities that they serve. And actually, the goals of digital health technology aren't only to create more efficient and effective care delivery, but to increase access and quality of care for all populations. That's certainly one of the goals that we have at Aldawould. And while there've been lots of documented improvements in access, quality and efficiencies of care for so many patients, these inequalities do still persist. And as a result, these populations that face disparities continue to experience them. And in some cases, digital health can actually exacerbate health inequalities, which is just morally wrong. So language barriers, is it acceptable that most patient-facing digital health solutions are in only one language, in English? I do understand some of the concerns because there are some tools like Google translation tools that technology companies are worried about misrepresenting, especially clinical terminology. But is that right? You know, it really does exclude and widens health inequalities. In Bradford, for example, we have a huge diverse population, but actually from recent evidence, we've seen that less than 20% of those that need interpreters or translations actually receive it. The majority will just use family, friends, bilingual staff, or just forgo their rights because of the unavailability. And can you imagine how difficult that will be for patients when they've got very sensitive matters that they want to discuss? Digital health interventions have an enormous potential as scalable tools to improve health and care by improving effectiveness, efficiency, accessibility, safety, and personalization. But I did want to talk briefly about AI and data biases, because AI is just such a huge area that is emerging. But bad data used to train AI can contain implicit racial, gender, or ideological biases. And actually, the vast majority of AI applications today are based on the category of algorithms known as deep learning algorithms, which find patterns in data. And two main ways that data bias shows up in the training data that these algorithms are used on, it's either the data you collect is unrepresentative of reality, or it reflects existing prejudices. So the first case might be an algorithm that is fed on photos, more photos of light-skinned faces than dark-skinned faces. So the algorithm would then inevitably be worse at recognizing darker-skinned faces. The second case is what happened when Amazon discovered that their recruiting tool, they created an algorithm, was dismissing female candidates because it was trained on historical hiring decisions which favored men over women. So the algorithm learned to do the same. Fortunately, there's a strong contingent of AI researchers working hard to address this problem, and they're looking at algorithms that detect and mitigate hidden biases within the training data, and that mitigate biases learned by the models regardless of the data quality, and also processes that hold companies accountable to fairer outcomes and discussions that hash out the different definitions of fairness. So the potential for the rising use of algorithms to improve analysis and management of health data is really well documented. But it's also the technology that demonstrates the potential pitfalls of poor diversity. And actually, more recently, an area that's received coverage for its failure to BAME communities is the lack of representation in COVID-19 data analysis and storage. So that has been a big recent issue. So more about my organisation, Aldawould. I created that out of a clinical need and a clinical problem in the NHS, which is around supporting flexibility of the workforce. And what our technology does, it breaks down a typical shift, which most clinicians are used to working in, into smaller amounts of work, chunks of work, and actually patient level. So what we do by integrating with the electronic patient record, we are able to know the real-time requirements of patients in that point of time. And this allows clinicians who can set preferences. So that might be my personal ability. I can consult in Arabic as well as English, obviously. And that can then be matched to what the patient needs, their language preferences. And it also supports less than full-time clinicians, those that might be retiring or on retainers, especially GPs, but it works for a multidisciplinary team. And because it reduces the health inequalities and communication barriers, because patients are more likely to be seen by a healthcare professional who speaks the same language, who's local to them, that makes just a huge difference in how patients are treated. And it also allows clinicians to work flexibly, to be matched to patients that are reflective of their interests and specialties and experience. And that way, we've proven that we can create additional capacity, reduce risks, and improve patient safety. But I wanted to end on a lot of the things I've learned, and actually more recently during COVID. Dr. Nikki Kenani, she set up a fantastic WhatsApp group. She entitled it the BAME Primary Care Leaders. That is such a rich environment that I've been learning a lot from leaders in BAME. And I've also learned over the years from friends and colleagues, you know, our very own Richard Stubbs and other digital tech founders. There are a really good number, Sandeep from Medic Bleep, Galib Khan from Written Medicine, Ishani from Lantum, other health BME leaders, Sam Shah, Masood Nazir, Minal Thakai. They have been absolutely great, and there are great leaders and great digital tech founders. So I'm really hopeful of the future. You know, we've described some of these challenges, and I think we're bringing these to the forefront of some of the issues that we're talking about. And I thank you for your time and look forward to discussions, question and answers, and just a really rich conversation. Thank you, Lou.
Thanks so much, Taz. That was great. And you referenced a couple of things. I actually put them in the chat. I put the Good Things Foundation and also the book that you mentioned, because I know that's, it was published a while ago, wasn't it? But it really resonates now and more than ever, I think.
You've got to read this book. There's another fantastic book that I plugged again, no connection to the guy, but Black Box Thinking for Patient Safety. You've got to read it.
Yeah, who's that by again?
Matthew Syed.
Oh, so the same author.
Same author, yeah. And again, about diversity, rebel ideas. It really has expanded my views on that unconscious bias and diversity. Yeah.
Taz, just before we hand over to Owen, you were part of the NHS Innovator Accelerator Programme. Is that right?
I wasn't, actually. No, I've been part of various other accelerators. But to be honest, because of the HSN support, I am considering the NIA programme for this cohort, because I've heard some people like Liz, I'm good friends with Liz, yeah. Ashley Payne and others that have been on it, and they talk very highly about it. Yeah. So I am considering it, but I've just had such great support from the likes of the HSN and others. So I'm just making sure it's
a value. Yeah, of course. And they have their own Propel program, which again, you know, gets you right into the heart of the NHS. One quick question, it's a big question, but it's a question somebody's popped on here about, you know, what's one thing really that you could recommend for startups, you know, from your background, from a BAME background, is there anything in particular that you might recommend that you know is a barrier for them?
I mean, this doesn't just apply to BAME background. I think recognize very early what your strengths are and identify your gaps and bring in people that you trust. And actually, most of those will be through recommendations. So, you know, people in Richard's team will know others like me, and you filter out the people that are all talk, and you will get to people who add a lot of value and that will fill the gaps. Obviously, I'm going to say, don't surround yourself by head nodders that are just going to agree with you. Get those diverse thinkers in there that will challenge you and disagree with you. That is so important that I've learned. You know, I applied for SBRI twice. First time, I tried to do it alone and didn't even get shortlisted. Wow. Second time, I brought in key people and you know, I was so worried about IP and things like that. But actually, I brought two or three key people in and just really allowed them to help shape some of the areas that I knew I wasn't strong in. And that was really critical to our success.
So you did succeed the second time?
We got in the second time, yeah, and then got the phase two bit. But it's a hard journey. You know, it's taken me 5 years to get to this point, and we're just at that sort of that inflection of scaling up. Mm-hmm. You know, it takes a lot of hard work, but you've got to surround yourself by people brighter than you, that are better than you, basically, mm-hmm. and bring them in, you know, and keep it diverse thinking, diverse backgrounds. That's probably, yeah. I'm happy to have an offline. I don't know who asked the question, but happy to.
I mean, it's somebody on the chat and she didn't give her full name. It's Mona, but I'm sure she can connect with you on Twitter or LinkedIn. Yeah. If she wants to ask you anything else. Okay, thank you so much, Taz.